Which side are you on, boys? Which side are you on? Which side are you on, boys? Which side are you on? They say in Harlan County there are no neutrals there. You'll either be a Union man or a thug for J.H. Blair. Which side are you on, boys? Which side are you on?
Welcome, fellow plebs. My name is Sean, and this is
Tribunus Plebis.
Welcome, everybody, to episode 14. This is a little bit of a special edition podcast. I was not planning on actually making a podcast on this subject. And this episode is going to probably be a little shorter than most. I don't know exactly how long it'll be, but I wanted to push off my regular episode idea and address this presidential debate nonsense and Donald Trump himself. It's not going to be very polished either, if I'm being honest with you guys. And I'll warn you, this episode will probably have a few more cuss words in it than my other episodes, and if you like Trump, you might want to just pull that eject lever and bail out now. Some things will be said. It will hurt to hear them. I can't apologize for it, but I can honestly tell you that it does not feel good to say this stuff. So let's have that hard conversation. So I watched the first half hour of the presidential debate on September 29th. The first one of a series of four, I think. My wife and I were watching, and I was mildly bemused at the utter shit show that was unspooling at an uncontrolled rate on my television screen. Just yards and yards of unfettered nonsense, lies, insults, and bully-like behavior. A national debate turned national embarrassment. At about the 30-minute mark, my wife said, "I can't listen to this anymore." So I turned the TV off and I saw her wiping her eyes. I asked if she was crying, and she had, indeed, teared up. She said essentially that she could not believe that somebody who would act like Donald Trump was acting is the president of the United States. And she was upset that the person challenging him was so utterly unable to respond in any effective fashion. "I can't believe that these are our choices," she said. "And neither can I. It's fucking depressing." After we hugged, she said, "These people are supposed to care about us." What was left unsaid is the rather obvious, that they do not, in fact, care about us. Last episode, I said that if you ever want to figure out what politicians are going to do, especially when they are in a group, just figure out what action would harm us the most directly. And that's it. That's the choice that they are going to make. They do not care about us. That includes Joe Biden. That includes, certainly, Donald Trump. My wife just said it in 100 fewer words and far more simply. We then watched a couple episodes of Scrubs to cleanse the palate and laugh a little bit before going to bed. But I listened to the rest of this absolutely sorry mess of a so-called debate the next day. On one side was Joe Biden, career politician and mediocrity incarnate. On the other side, Trump. Insane, authoritarian, reactionary shitbag. I'm not going to sit here and break down every bonkers exchange from that night. It was bewildering to behold, and the insanity came with such volume and intensity that words can't possibly do it justice. The one moment that stood out the most, and this is the same moment that basically everybody has fixated on, is a sitting president of this country simply refusing to condemn white supremacy. Even sadder, it's not his first time being unable to do this simple thing. Think about that. Just really sit back for a moment and really wrangle with that fact. The leader of this country, the United States of America, refuses to condemn white supremacists. I mean, part of me was like, yeah, of course, America, right? What else do we expect? But there was another part of me, the still incredulous part that was like, what the fuck am I witnessing here? Is this reality right now? Trump really won't do this. What could ever be easier to do? The only way that saying that you condemn racists is difficult to do is, well, if you're a racist. That's it. That's the sum total of situations where condemning racists becomes difficult. I mean, I've said it a few times in this podcast already, but Trump is a racist. I 100% believe that to be true. He is authoritarian, fascistic, and that's another term I've avoided until recently, but he is fascistic, even if he doesn't quite understand what that means. He's racist, misogynist, petulant, and, in the end, simply crude and cruel. And I'd like to think that this took us by surprise, but it didn't. In November of 2016, on the night that Trump got elected, I wrote a post on my Facebook page that I will read a few excerpts from here. It started off with this. Well, America, we wanted change, and we wanted an outsider. I think we failed on both counts. I believe that we just elected a social, political, and economic disaster for the history books. Like the type of unmitigated disaster our grandkids will hate us for. I mean, that looks about right to me so far. I think I was pretty much on the nose there. And it continued, we've set back our civil liberties, our personal sovereignty, and our financial stability. We've reaffirmed the failed status quo of neoliberal economic doctrine, and we've reaffirmed a crippling conservatism I was hopeful was on its way out. So check, 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 and yep, check. Continuing on, I'm actually legitimately worried about my wife, who's a minority, in the America of a man who was openly endorsed by the KKK and white supremacists. I worry about the wives of some of my best friends who are minorities as well. I worry about them all simply because they are female and non-white. And then there are my gay family members. I love you guys. Sorry, fellas. I'm worried about you too, and all my gay and lesbian friends out there, and all the minorities and immigrants in this country. Yep, the sadness is beginning to creep in now as the accuracy grows even clearer. And here's a little more. I'm sad for all of us. I promise to continue to fight for you in whatever pittance my voice adds to the cacophony. And that, in hindsight, was a poorly crafted sentence, but I hope you get the point. And I'm extremely happy that I did not let myself and anyone else down by not following through on that last part. Even if it has done no good at all, I did add my voice to the cacophony, first with my blog, and now with this podcast. That Facebook post ended with these lines. I'm furious that this is something I'm actually fucking thinking about in fucking 2016. Worst of all, we did it with a smug, Trump-like grin on our face. The national nightmare begins today and continues for 4 years. I actually hope I'm wrong. I'd rather not be right. And that last line, I really meant it. The replies to this post were half agreement and half Trump voters telling me to wait and see. I promised I'd wait and see and try to keep an open mind and repeated that I hoped I was wrong. And I would have absolutely loved to have been wrong. Because me being wrong would have meant that Trump brought unity, love, reconciliation, equity, peace, and stability. It would have meant that my country became a better place to live and not a worse one. It would have meant a repudiation of neoliberalism, crippling conservatism, wanton cruelty, and blood sport politics. It would have meant more freedom, more civil liberty, and financial security. It would have meant a world safer for my wife and safer for all minorities, immigrants, disenfranchised, and oppressed. But I wasn't wrong. I was, much to my own true, honest disappointment, correct. It all came true. And I'm not a fucking soothsayer either. I don't have a crystal ball. I just listened to Trump. I listened to his words right from his own mouth. I wasn't warped by the mainstream media because I don't watch the news. I just listened to Trump and I listened to his supporters. He and they preached hatred. They preached America first as a gauzy veil for whites first. They peddled this false notion of making America great again because back then, white folks were on a pedestal that was a little higher than it is now. Yes, I was 100% sure it was a race thing. They preached us versus them. They preached violence, discord, and vitriol. And they preached jingoism as virtue. These people told us exactly what they wanted and what they'd do to get it. Trump voters like to dismiss all the racism and nationalism and complete and utter failures of this administration and say, well, look at the stock market. He renegotiated NAFTA. He reneged on this deal and that. America first, blah, 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 blah. Whatever it is they say. Man, fuck the stock market. It's not the economy. It doesn't mean shit. I could sit here and try to explain to you that he didn't even do anything amazing with the stock market. It just continued a climb begun under Obama, but at a slower rate, and you wouldn't believe it anyway. Because Obama was black, or he had a Muslim name, or you just didn't like him because he used big words or something. Plus, the whole stock thing is another episode entirely, so I'm just going to push on past this. And the USMCA, the new NAFTA, is like 0.2% different than the old NAFTA, and no jobs came back. Sadly, no Trump voters actually list some of the good things that happened, because they don't care about that. They don't care about criminal justice reform, even if it was weak and half-assed. Because they don't actually care, period. They are either fully in the cult of personality slash make the libs cry crowd, or they're racists. That's pretty much it. Sorry, I know some of you voted for this person, but it has to be said. Please prove me wrong. Donald Trump is an absolute monster. A racist, demagogic monster. And we have seen his racism and race baiting play out during this coronavirus pandemic as well. Trump has constantly thrown around terms like the Chinese virus, the Wuhan, and the Kung flu. And the cultural racism with the talk about filth and bat soup and so-called wet markets. He has blamed the Chinese at every opportunity as cover for his own failings. And his supporters just said, oh, he's just being funny. Popular podcast hosts have said that Kung flu is funny. That is okay because, hey, it's just humor. But it's not just humor. Words actually do have consequences. My wife is Asian. She was born in Korea. She has a circle of friends who have experienced racism as a direct result of this sort of rhetoric. I saw photos of two women, both bloody and bruised, who were physically attacked because they were Asian and they were accused of bringing COVID to the U.S. And all that, on top of the more widespread, nationally broadcast incidences of racist violence against Asians. Right now, my wife feels a need to wear large sunglasses when she feels the need to wear large sunglasses when she drives to hide her eyes. Sorry, it's a little emotional for me. It's hard enough to think that stuff without actually saying it out loud. She feels like she has to hide her eyes, to hide the most unchangeable aspect of who she is, because for her, an Asian woman, the threat from this rhetoric is real. This isn't a thought experiment. People are being attacked simply because they are Asian because of these words. And this inability of the President of the United States, the person with the biggest bully pulpit on the planet, to condemn racists because he knows that these racists support him, is all we need to know about him. Even now, right now, this very day, even now, my wife still feels the need to cover her eyes, specifically because this proud boy, stand back, stand by bullshit is real to her. Half of my blog posts were about this demagoguery, rhetoric, and the stochastic nature of this racism and terror. And if you think that this will stop with Asians or blacks or whatever other ethnicity or group you can think of, you are dead wrong. Dead fucking wrong. It will never stop. Another moment from this debate that stuck out to me was an exchange about Joe Biden's sons. Biden brought up his son Beau, who served in the Middle East and died of cancer, while attacking Trump's comments about soldiers being suckers and losers. So as Biden is talking about his dead child, Trump says, to paraphrase a little bit, "I don't know Beau. I know Hunter. He's the one who did cocaine." The abject, naked, raw cruelty of this so-called man is disgusting. To look another man who has just talked about his deceased child in the eye and to tell them, "I do not know that kid. I know your other kid who did drugs," is just sick. It is noxious. Who the fuck can accept this? How can anyone who claims to have any sort of moral base be okay with this? How can people cheer for this? How can they vote for this? How is anything at all a worthy trade-off for that? The answer is that it isn't. No numbers on a Dow or S&P graph are worth this level of inhumanity. None. It's absolutely fucking stunning to me, and I am pretty goddamn cynical at this point, that Americans are actually standing for this monster. I drive around Massachusetts and Connecticut, and I see a disturbing amount of Trump signs and flags. The neighbor across the street just put one up. So that guy's an asshole too, I guess. Wonderful. I hope we all got our lulls over the last 4 years. And the obvious truth here is that societies are easy to tear apart, but I think we will find that they are incredibly difficult to stitch back together and to heal. There's going to be a lot of scars running through this country and its people, and the people to blame know who they are. They know what they've done. Now, I know a lot of people don't care about politics. They think it's pointless. A lot of my friends think like this. They don't want to participate. And I get it. It's messy, it's imperfect, it's definitely corrupt, and it is trying on emotional and psychic levels if you have any sense of morality, ethics, or honor. But this stuff has real consequences. Laughing as you vote for a racist chaos candidate just to throw a sabot into the machine so you can see what happens isn't funny. This isn't a game of Sims. There is no saved game to go back to. There's a reason why you don't just toss a handful of ball bearings into a nest of high-speed gears. Because that very important life support machine might break, and people are going to get hit with the shrapnel and be harmed. Are you sitting in your nice suburbs and watching the news and saying, "Isn't he crazy?" while shoveling food into your mouths as people are beaten in the streets, murdered by cops, disenfranchised, disowned, imprisoned, tortured, and terrorized for your cheap entertainment. Isn't that funny? Seriously, it's not funny at all. The emotional, psychic, and physical pain of other people is not fodder for the humor banks. The emotional, psychic, and physical pain of other people exists. It's real. Real life has real consequences. Hiring an insane, blowhard, racist game show host to guide our country has consequences. And those consequences were obvious 4 years ago, 5 years ago, as soon as this inhuman monster descended that ridiculous fucking escalator to announce his candidacy by insulting Mexicans. There has to be a reckoning here somewhere. If you're listening to this, I hope that you mostly enjoy what I am trying to say with these podcasts. I really do. And I do my best to be even-handed and not go off the handle. Even if it doesn't always seem that way, I really do try. And most everyone I've talked to who listens to this show mostly agrees with me, at least broadly. And I'll acknowledge here that most of my listeners are friends, and anyone who thinks I'm stupid probably is too kind to say so. But at least a few of these people who have listened and talked to me probably voted for Trump, and they might vote for him again. And here, the disconnect lies. If you voted for Trump, and or are going to vote for him again, and you generally agree with what I've written or said, I don't get it. I really don't. My views on the world, how I see things and try to explain, act out, and fully live, cannot mesh with voting for Trump. The ethos of the project that is Tribunus Plebis is impossible to reconcile with support of Donald Trump. While no president in my lifetime, and realistically never, has ever really been aligned with the intent of this project, none of them have ever been so diametrically opposed as Donald Trump. If I were to make the case here for Biden, I'd say that while he kinda sucks, and he does, he's a banal sort of Democratic career politician, with all of the pluses and minuses such a status conveys. But Trump is a reactionary, authoritarian, thoughtless, and outright dangerous person. Like, literally dangerous to American citizens. His rhetoric and its demagogic and stochastic nature are dangerous to my own wife's well-being, just because her eyes are shaped a little bit differently than my own. You can take a listen to episodes 2, 3, and 4 for more on that stuff. Oh, and also episode 7. And episodes 8 and 9. And 10 as well. And those 9 episodes are just the tip of the iceberg as far as harm from our current president goes. None of this is a secret. But this trash heap of a debate just sort of laid all the nerves bare. Stop being feckless. Open your eyes. Look at the hurt we've caused. Look at the pain. Understand what we've wrought unto ourselves. Go back and look at that fucking disaster that we called a debate. Go watch it. Go see how the President of the United States behaved. Go listen to what he said. Notice what he refused to say. Watch his cruelty. Just the acidic, caustic, dehumanizing, evil cruelty of it all. Understand the real pain that this monster has caused. Try to empathize with the people he and his administration are harming. Try to understand how my wife's phenotypical traits put her in danger because of this man. If you can understand and empathize, you'll know what to do. If you can't empathize, maybe that's the problem. In the end, we have to ask ourselves, how the fuck can we justify voting for this monster again, even after all of this pain? How is that option even possible?